a fight over a U.S. investment bill, a devastating typhoon in the Philippines, and could Israel be in even more danger? Here to discuss it all is our foreign affairs correspondent, Lisa Dafatari, joining us from Los Angeles. Lisa, welcome once again to the show. So great to have you on.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. So President Joe Biden's hoping to pass a $1.75 trillion domestic investment bill, which is known as the Build Back Better, and aims to expand the social safety net and tackle climate change. But Democratic U.S. Senator Joe Manchin said on Sunday that he would not support the bill. So is this a fatal blow to Biden, Lisa?
Well, perhaps, right? So obviously all eyes are on Manchin. This was a very brave move by the Democratic senator because, they're expected to go along party lines and support everything the president wants and what the Democrats want. And you have very progressive and very vocal lawmakers like Ilhan Omar and Bernie Sanders saying this is just BS and they're very disappointed in him. While you have Republicans championing Senator Manchin and saying, thank you for being moderate. Thank you for being sensible. Thank you for being sane. Obviously, this is not where the money and priority should go. We've always had this battle, especially in more recent years among Democrats and Republicans, Democrats wanting to just spend, a lot of focus on climate change, a lot of things that Republicans don't consider the priority, particularly right now when we're having a devastating economy here in the United States. Basic food costs, double, triple the amount it did just 2-3 years ago. You're paying $6 at the gas pump per gallon in many, many cities. And, it's the holidays, right? So it's very difficult for people like Manchin to really prioritize things other than the nuclear family and their basic goods and the economy and to get people back to work and to get everything going again. This, as we have another variant, sweeping through. So I think that it's a good time for people to cross over the political aisle to see what's sensible, what works, and what really does Build Back Better mean. It doesn't particularly have to do with infrastructure or climate change, but maybe it has to do with building back what American priorities are and what is most important to Americans right now.
Mm-hmm. Does it seem to you that he took more of a Republican stance? Like I said, it comes as no surprise that this senator is being slammed by other politicians, particularly on his own side, for not supporting Biden's bill. And I saw that tweet from Omar, by the way. It was, I didn't know that politicians could talk that way on Twitter.
Yeah, this squad, as they call themselves, and I hate to give them more credit than they're due. But they don't act in a very, typical or professional manner. In many ways, they are the bullies, right? So they tweet whatever they want. They spew a lot of hatred, They feel like they can bully their way into getting more power and more influence than, newcomers to the Congress should have, right? And look at the amount of media attention that is on them. Ilhan Omar or AOC or Rashida Tlaib, they can tweet something. And of course, it gets all these headlines just because it is so radical. And it is something that we're not used to. Typical politicians who go to Washington to do their job, that's not how they speak. And to your question, I think it's a great question. Do we consider this a Republican move by Manchin, or is it just him being sensible and making a decision based on what he believes is pragmatic and not what a party dictates? And I think that that's an important way to move forward. Right now, we are seeing a lot of politicians having to switch parties just because they have certain beliefs about a certain topic, right? And it's a very isolated topic. And then, we're not allowing politicians to say what makes sense to me. If I don't believe this, I don't want to be canceled by my party. Manchin right now facing all of this scrutiny. Why? Because he decided on something independently and not along party lines. But again, cancel culture is after him. I wouldn't be surprised if he switched parties because of this. And look, for a lot of these old school Democrats, if you line up their political views from decades back, They sound like Republicans. Joe Biden himself, roll back the tape, right? You're watching him in like the 80s, the 90s, even about 5, 6, 7 years ago, and he sounds very different than what the Democratic Party is today. And again, people like the squad, these women, others like Bernie Sanders, are pushing the Democrat Party further and further left. They want it to be the progressive party. They want it to be the socialist party. That's just not American. And I think that traditional Democrats are finding a very, very, very difficult to find a place at home in their party.
Mm-hmm. It's happening up here too. You're getting people crossing the line, so to speak. It's kind of interesting to see what's happening. Now, you mentioned earlier the variant, which is kind of making headlines everywhere. So this Omicron variant is hitting Europe with supersonic speed, and public health experts there are warning that the U.S. could be headed in the same direction, facing record waves of infection in the coming days and weeks. Biden actually saying that this could be a winter of death. Is this a little extreme, Lisa, or should we be concerned about this? What are you hearing?
You know, more fear-mongering tactics from the White House, and we're not surprised. So let's start with Europe. Yes, we're always looking at Europe first, because that's how it initially took Europe by wave. If you remember, Italy, France, the UK reporting, you know, all those cases and deaths, unfortunately, in the first months of this pandemic. Then it came over to the United States. We had New York City hit really badly until it traveled into places like California. Big cities hit very, very hard. Again, we are already experiencing that in the United States, with New York City and Los Angeles experiencing, again, reporting daily record highs, not hospitalizations, by the way. They're calling this more of an Omicold than Omicron, meaning it might be a great way for people to get immunity with a cold that is not as bad as what the original or Delta, which was a worse variant, more severe variant, was. We're not seeing the number of hospitalizations, but the White House sending out a message saying that if you are vaccinated and boosted, of course, well, then you should be fine. But if you're not vaccinated, prepare for a winter of death. This is literally coming from the White House. That's not exactly the cozy Christmas message we expect from the White House, but we're not surprised. They're taking this as an opportunity to push the agenda. Look, if the boosters worked, we wouldn't have all these breakout cases. If the vaccine worked, we wouldn't have all these breakout cases. But of course, it is preventing hospitalization, which is a wonderful thing. But, you know, it maybe the natural immunity from this variant that is not as dangerous might be actually a good thing. We can hopefully work towards that herd immunity that we talk about. Hopefully we can put a little of that fear-mongering aside for the holidays.
Yeah, exactly. Nothing like a message that says Merry Christmas, prepare for death, right? And you'd mentioned the immunity. So we're hearing that this super immunity, so to speak, could be possible with this. Would this be people who have been vaccinated and then got COVID and then are over it? It's actually increased their chances of getting over it by, what is it, 1,000% or something? What are you hearing?
1,000-fold, right. Mm-hmm. So it's very interesting, because all along, people who have had COVID, whether it was in the initial phases or throughout, or have had their kids have COVID, have argued that their immunity should take the place of a vaccination, meaning, you know, they have more immunity than the average person who is vaccinated and perhaps even boosted. And now with Omicron, they're saying, yes, that is actually the case, that if you do get this variant, you will be better protected than somebody who is vaccinated and boosted. And you know what? It's just, it seems like a crapshoot, right? We're just making it up as we're going. And obviously, some of it's based on science, some of it's based on fear, and some of it's based on changing the initial science that we believed once was true. You know, it's very difficult. A lot of people are doing immunity tests to see if they should get boosted. In some countries, they're doing a fourth booster already. So these places, I might add, Jeanette, they're still having breakout cases. So people are still getting COVID. And again, it will prevent the serious cases, the hospitalizations, perhaps the need to get oxygen and get on a ventilator, which again, is a wonderful thing. But there are breakout cases. And again, this natural immunity that one can develop from actually getting COVID, they're saying is going to far, far supersede that what one can get at based on a vaccine.
Yeah. Okay. Well, turning our attention now from COVID to the Middle East, an Arabic language Twitter account of the Islamic Republic of Iran over the weekend tweeting a threatening image regarding Israel Lisa, the images insinuate the planned elimination of the Jewish state. What's going on?
It's startling. If you see this, and I tweeted it out with an explanation of what it is just a bunch of matches in the shape of the country of Israel, and then a little matchbook, and then it says basically like, try us, right? An open threat using the American owned Twitter platform, which cancels everyone who has an opinion. You know, Donald Trump can't be on there. So many conservatives can't be on there. But yet the Taliban is on Twitter and Hamas is on Twitter and the Islamic Republic of Iran is on Twitter, actually making threats against a sovereign state in the Middle East. So it's a very interesting time, I have to add. At the same time, when they're making this threat against our main ally in the Middle East, we are at the negotiating table trying to strike a deal with the Iran's government. What does this show? I mean, what kind of cooperation does this show? What kind of change in behavior does this show? They are threatening to blow a country off the map, our main ally in the region, and here we are pining for a handshake with a country that we know is going to get the nuclear weapons, is going to continue putting its money towards terrorism, will continue its human rights abuses back at home. And here we are. Look, it just doesn't look good. We are on the wrong side of this. History will judge us very, very poorly. And this, after the debacle that happened in Afghanistan, this administration has been on the wrong side. Just frankly, it's as simple as that. They've been on the wrong side. If they flip the coin, they'd probably have better accuracy with regards to foreign policy. But what's going on with the Iranian regime is wrong. We have 80 million people in the Iranian population that are telling us, the majority of them telling us, that their government has done nothing but abuse them and kill them and torture them. And they're basically shooting at protesters that are coming out onto the streets in peaceful protest. And here we are trying to strike a deal with them at the table and really normalizing and justifying a lot of the actions of this very brutal regime.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned the talks between Iran and the U.S. How are those talks going?
Yeah, look, the optics are not good, right? Not only are these other extenuating circumstances going on, right? We're finding out that they're not cooperating with the IAEA in the best way possible to give us transparency about their nuclear program. We're finding out that they are enriching uranium at percentages above what they should be doing. We, again, shooting at protesters, doing their normal, putting money into Yemen and to Iraq and to Hamas and into Gaza and all those places where they support terrorism. But you have the officials coming away from the negotiating table saying, this is really not working. It's not looking good. We're trying to get back into an Obama-era nuclear deal. And things are not even as good as they were back then. And that was a bad deal. Let me tell you, that was a bad deal. And now it seems like the Iranian regime thinks that they can get away with more. They know that the guy who's in the White House wants this deal more than the Obama administration wanted it, if that's even possible, so that they know that they're the ones who could call the shots. They know that they don't have to make any compromises. They're not making any concessions. And in fact, we're hearing that they're making more demands. So they haven't been able to get anywhere with the negotiation so far. And we know that the clock is ticking and time is running out. But again, they know we want it, and they will do whatever it takes. And guess what? We do want it. And they're going to continue going back to the negotiating table until they probably get a deal.
Wow. And speaking of time running out, we only have a couple minutes left, and I wanted to get to this devastating typhoon that hit the Philippines. So the death toll has reached at least 146, and they say it's the strongest typhoon to hit the Philippines this year. I believe there's been a number of them, and greater devastation might be yet to reported. Lisa, what's going on? What are the details there?
Yeah, the footage is awful. I don't know if you had a chance to look at this, Jeanette, but I encourage everyone to do so and keep an eye on it and help out as best as possible. These are areas that are prone to getting typhoons. It's the climate in the area. They're calling out for help. Many, many people missing. So that death toll will rise significantly, unfortunately. Devastation. It's just all of this rubble. They can't get through it quickly enough to get the people out of harm's way. And again, the infrastructure there is just not equipped to handle this kind of natural disaster. So they're in our prayers, they're in our thoughts. And if you can get any kind of help or aid over there, you can give a few dollars online to help them out. It's a wonderful thing to do during the holidays, especially. And we hope that the world bodies can get them some actual legitimate help that can get these people out of harm's way soon enough.
Yeah, absolutely. We definitely pray for everyone there in the Philippines. Absolutely, our hearts are with them, especially during this time, during the holidays and stuff. Just what a time to be hit with devastation. Absolutely. Lisa, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
My pleasure. My pleasure. It's always nice to have a conversation with you.
Great. Thank you so much. Lisa Dafatari is our foreign affairs correspondent joining us from Los Angeles. I'm Jeanette Roche on behalf of all of us here at Bridge City News. Thanks for watching.